Thank you very much for your attendance. I'm Philip Lipsy, and I direct the Center for the Study of Global Japan at the University of Toronto. Welcome to today's event, Japan's Aging Peace, Pacifism, and Militarism in the 21st Century, a book talk by Professor Tom Lee. I would like to thank Mio Otsuka, our events and program coordinator, as well as Tara Dumbaz and Adam Bell, the Monk School, for their support of this event. Before we begin, I would like to deliver a land acknowledgement. We wish to acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. Following the panel presentations, we will have a Q&A session. Please use the built-in Q&A feature on Zoom, or feel free to email csgj.monk@utoronto.ca to submit your questions directly. You should feel free to submit your questions at any time. It won't disrupt the presentation if you submit your question during the presentation. With that, it's a great pleasure today to welcome Professor Tom Lee to talk about his new and important book, Japan's Aging Peace, Pacifism, and Militarism in the 21st Century. Tom is an associate professor of politics at Pomona College and a research associate at the Prime Institute at Meiji Gakuin University. His research areas include Japanese security policy, the U.S.-Japan alliance, war memory and reconciliation, militarism norms, military and security balance in East Asia, and East Asian regionalism. Aside from the book he will talk about today, he has published articles in outlets like the Journal of Asian Studies and Journal of Asian Security and International Affairs, and he provides insightful public commentary in a variety of outlets, including the Nikkei Asian Review, the Washington Post, and Foreign Affairs. He received a PhD in political science from the University of California, Irvine, and BAs in history and political science from the University of California, Davis. Tom's book, which I have right here, very, very nice cover, by the way, reflects very meticulous and time-consuming fieldwork in Japan, covering over 2.5 years and over 70 interviews with policymakers and other stakeholders. He skillfully combines and links insights from the constructivist literature about the importance of ideational and normative factors in international relations and the Japanese security literature, which has often emphasized material factors like the changing policies of Japan in response to the rise of geopolitical threats, including China and North Korea. His analysis of multiple militarisms is an important contribution to our understanding of contemporary Japanese security policy. And in my view, the book deserves to be widely read and reflected upon. The topic, of course, is also timely given the upcoming election in Japan and intensifying debates about security policy on major topics, like the potential acquisition of strike capabilities by Japan, and whether Japan should play a larger role vis-a-vis the security of Taiwan, among many others. So with that, Tom, it is a great pleasure to welcome you to our seminar series, and we look forward to learning from you and exchanging our thoughts about where Japan is headed today. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Philip. Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us today. I'd just like to thank Professor Philip Lipsy for inviting me here. This is my first book talk, and this is the first time I'm testing it in the wild. I actually didn't do a workshop or anything like that, and I just kind of wrote it and sent it out. So I'm very excited about the comments and questions and critiques people may have. So today I'll be giving a discussion on parts of the book on Japan's aging peace. First, I'd like to acknowledge and thank all the institutions that provided funding and support to this project over the last couple of years. Additionally, I had a great group of research assistants at the Pomona Colleges. I've had a total of over 10 students that were able to help me find data and just sit around and discuss with me this. I always like to give them some good credit for their contribution to the book. So for today, the basic outline is I'll provide some context on Japanese security or on the regional environment, then look at some of the literature and the arguments that are made, provide my research question, give a brief outline, and then look at the theory and concepts. And I'm looking at two dimensions today. It's the demographics of Japan's security situation, and then what I call rules and rule, what I consider the software. So if you think about the material dimensions, it's kind of like a computer, hardware, your processor and things such as that, is the bodies that make up the self-defense force. And then the software are the rules that guide on how they're going to be used. So if we look at the regional politics that Japan's concerned with versus with North Korea, the historical security issues that Japan has to deal with, it's rapidly developing nuclear program and increased capabilities of its missile program. And then there's very specific issues to Japan as well, such as the abduction issue, where at least under Prime Minister Abe, this was a major issue for him as a concern when it comes to how North Korea is framed as a security threat. Then if we look at China, which is the major focus, I think, in the literature on why many have argued that Japan is militarizing or normalizing, it looks at how China has overtaken Japan economically and militarily over the last few decades. China's presence around the world is increasing, and its confidence in pressing its claims has increased. And then also uncertainty with the US alliance, especially under President Trump, which kind of suggests that Japan might consider a more independent military standing. So if we look at kind of the expression of Japan's security concerns, it's easier to see how dramatic it is. Here's one of the artificial islands that China is developing in 2012 and 2015. And by 2016, you have a fully developed artificial island. So there seems to suggest there's very obvious reasons on why Japan should militarize. And I think the literature has done a great job at explaining that. If we look at military spending in the region over the last few decades, you can see China in blue, their share of regional defense spending has significantly increased. And relatively, Japan's military spending has decreased compared to what we would consider its rivals. And then if we apply the historical dimension to it too, Japan doesn't have natural allies in the region due to its historical actions, the colonial era and World War II. If you look at public opinion and of China, of Japan, it's really high. So in some ways, Japan's best ally, its closest ally, is the United States, which is the country that it fought a world war with, right? So in some ways, one can see why Japan, when it feels cornered, it might suggest that they would try to normalize or increase their capabilities if the region is changing. Then you look at this US-Japan alliance, there's always the concern about abandonment by the United States and entrapment of Japan being forced into conflicts that it's not interested in. And so therefore it might wanna be a more independent state. Japan's always wondering how can it be a better ally, a more equal ally, or a dependable ally. So there's this push and pull in the alliance in which Japan should do more to maintain the alliance, but it doesn't wanna do too much because it might be pulled into the US orbit. Additionally, there's more threats in the international community than ever before, which may suggest Japan should increase its capabilities with international terrorism, cybersecurity, environmental insecurity, human security, such as inequality, migration, and poverty, and rocky relations with ROK. So there's so much to suggest that Japan should normalize. And then, you know, President Trump, when he was president just not too long ago, he, you know, said several things about the allies free riding and really pressuring Japan and South Korea to spend so much more on the military. There's so many incentives for Japan to really go its own way and to secure its fate on its own. So, but if we look at Japanese security concerns, then we could start complicating it, that if we look at all these things, it takes many different characters, which may require a type of militarism or security policy that's not simply balancing or increasing the capabilities, that's how it's gonna use the military. So the first, I would say, security concern that we have to think about is that Japan's social security in terms of its aging and declining population, work-life balance, and all the things that are necessary to keep the country growing at a healthy rate. Additionally, there's the traditional state security that I think the literature does a great job explaining, the rising China and terrorism and the things I spoke about. And more so than ever, I would say natural disasters and climate change are a major concern for Japan. This is very true after 3/11. And then there's economic security with decades of anemic growth, global competition, supply chain issues, the BRI. So if you think about Japanese security concerns, they're quite broad. And here are some of the developments over the years in which Japan is trying to address some of the more traditional securities, right? So you have, I would say, major security legislation, such as the establishment of the National Security Council, like a permanent body that is ready to go instead of addressing security problems in an ad hoc manner. There's the National Security Strategy, amendment to the U.S.-Japan Alliance, our guidelines, and then an amendment to the arms export ban. And then I would say, like, qualitatively, at least in terms of how Japan packages these actions, I would say Prime Minister's proactive peace doctrine does it, where it talks about how Japan should play a greater role leveraging its military capabilities to, commensurate of its economic power or reputational power. And if we look at the defensive paper of Japan page count, this is their official guidelines on, you can see over the years, the first year it was produced was 1970, and then there was a few years where they didn't produce it. It's just increased in terms of size and also depth and also range of issues that it covers. So it's clear that Japan is becoming much more sophisticated in how it's talking about its security issues. So if we look at the literature, there's a lot of discussion on how this came to be, right? So for the constructivists, such as Berger and Miyashita and Andrew Orse's book in 2008, Normalizing Japan, they do a wonderful job at looking at how anti-militarism norms can kind of limit Japan's security policy or growth or militarism in the context of maybe dangerous environment. And Andrew Orse's 2018 book, Japan Security Renaissance, I think he threads the needle quite well, explaining how the military policies become more pragmatic, but it still has a very Japanese character. For the realists, they look at the typical kind of traditional balancing behavior of states, the regional politics, and the U.S.-Japan alliance as kind of push factors for Japan to increase its capabilities. And then I would say there's the work by Paul Mitford and Dick Samuels, and Hirata, where they look at kind of domestic politics. So I think, if we're honest about it, every piece of the literature does capture part of the reality. I would never say that any of these are like completely wrong, but I think there's a way to make it work and describe a unique character of Japanese security, which can be used as a model to explain other countries' security as well. And lastly on this issue, if we look at the popular press, it's always saying how Japan is militarizing. Just think about how the United States just left Afghanistan, and the discussion on the Hill now is, should South Korea get nuclear weapons? Or what is Japan gonna do to defend Taiwan now that the attention has shifted to East Asia? The assumption is always, when is Japan going to act normal and increase its capabilities? So for the puzzle for me, or the research question is, given the multitude of reasons on why Japan should increase its capabilities and become more militaristic, why is the budget still limited? Why is the policies, I would argue, the constitution unamended? And why I would argue that it hasn't changed as much as the international security environment. So the question I ask is quite broad, which is what determines the content and direction of Japanese security policy. But what I'm looking at is how is force legitimized in domestic debates on why they need to increase the capabilities? And also, what is the interaction between the material world and the ideas that justify it? And I'll try to make that more clear in a later slide. And then also, I think this needed to be done was, how has Japanese anti-militarism evolved over time? If you look at the anti-militarism literature, a lot of it focuses on the early post-war period. And then it just assumes that the longer you go away, it just goes away, as opposed to evolve and maybe takes on new characters and new missions. And so the premises of my argument and of the book is security policy is as much of what a state can do as much as it should do. I think the literature does a great job of explaining the motivations on why Japan should militarize, but there's a limit to what you can do. You still have to pay for your soldiers, you have to find the soldiers, you have to build the equipment, and that's difficult to do. I would argue that politics is ultimately a normative exercise, right? If we look at David Easton's classic definition, like the government's politics is an authoritative allocation of values. So when the government decides to increase the defense budget by double, from 1% to 2%, it's telling the public and reflecting the values of what the public considers important or salient. And understanding how security is discussed can help us understand that. And I would argue this is what maybe a controversial argument in my book is that I argue that anti-militarism is a type of militarism. and that we have to get rid of this binary of pacifism and militarism. And there's like different ways in which we leverage the military for security purposes. So my argument is, I look at there's an interaction between the material and the ideational forces that constrain, that kind of physically hold back the self-defense forces, and then also restrain, which is Japan willingly forgoes certain capabilities. And anti-militarism, I would argue, is reified through time, experience, and practices. And together, it's called I call it an anti-militarism ecosystem. So we could look at it in two dimensions, the hardware dimension, and then there's the software dimension. So in the book, I have a couple of chapters that divide the book into the hardware parts, which is the demographics, the people, and the technology. And then the software parts is looking at the policies, like politics and the norms. And today I'll be touching on some of these chapters in the book. So let's start with norms, which are critical to the book. And as you know, the classic definition is norms are a standard of appropriate behavior for actors given a certain identity. They're regulative and constitutive, which means they limit what an agent will do, but also they will motivate states to do something as well. So the anti-militarism, we have to understand it as simply not limiting militarization or arms buildup, but also may motivate Japan to use its military in specific ways as well, such as promoting human security and things such as that. As we know, norms are intersubjective. That means they're shared between different agents. So this is not a pipe, but we know it's a pipe because we have a shared understanding of it. And then it's also important to kind of show that norms change over time. They don't just like disappear or come, but they can evolve. And we see that with Japanese anti-militarism norms. Here, I should note that it's important to think about like structure and our agents. So Japan is an agent, right? And it has a certain security policy. And the debate's always, given the structure of the international system, how will Japan's identity and its policies change because it has to adjust? But remember, Japan is part of the structure at the same time, right? You can't fully separate it. So as long as Japan maintains a certain security policy, the structure is different, that it's less militarized, and that may affect how the countries in that region behave. For the book, though, I use Nicholas Onuf's, beyond norms, I use rules, right? And really, if we just think about it this way, rules, norms, policies, they're all the same thing. They're guidelines on how do we behave, right? And different actors in society fight to create rules. They try to codify them in order to enact rule, which allows them to get what they want in order to ensure their privileges, right? Which is either economic or social or anything such as that. And therefore, if we look at anti-militarism norms generated by the public and the government, they are rules that try to lead the country to behave in a certain way to ensure privileges for some groups over others. And that's how I imagine Japanese security policy. So let's see how it plays together, norms and the physical environment. So here's an example. In basketball, there's a technique called walking the dog, right? Where you have 10 seconds to get the ball across the half court line. And so what players would do is they'll let the ball roll down the court, and then they won't touch the ball until they absolutely have to, but they could get the ball down the court without starting the 24 second clock, right? So the rules are you only have 10 seconds to go across. However, those rules can be interpreted in different ways. So players learn that you could let the ball roll without bouncing it right away. Yet, those rules are still bound by the physics of the court, the physics of 24 seconds or 12 or 10 seconds. And so the ideas, the normative rules, interact with the physical world to come up with specific outcomes. And that's how I'm looking at Japanese security policy. So if we take a look at this anti-militarism ecosystem, I argue that it's constrained and restrained in these four ways. First is the social structural, that if you look at the aging and declining population, that makes it very difficult for Japan to tax the public and also recruit to fill the military, quotas. And you can see how here demographics and norms can intersect. So for instance, there's an aging population crisis all over East Asia. That's a problem for South Korea, and it will be a significant problem for China. And I know Andrew Oros right now, I keep on citing him, but he keeps on doing the projects that I want to do. He's doing a new book project on America's aging allies, and he's going to look at the whole region, and I'm excited to see the impact of that. But However, the way the demographic crisis affects the security of each state is different, because the lesson that South Korea and China and other states drew from World War II was their military weakness was why their states suffered. So they're willing to have conscription in order to meet their military quotas. So the aging population, the material dimension has less of an effect on them because of the software dimension, which is their laws, right? Whereas Japan has similar hardware problems, but its software, which is its anti-militarism norm, its constitution, and its policies, make that hardware problem play out differently. Next, I would argue is the technical infrastructural, which is the basically the weapons that Japan has. And due to these militarism norms, it leads to changes in the physical capabilities of Japan's military. So for instance, in the United States, if you you graduate from Harvey Mudd or one of the great engineering schools and you get a job at Lockheed Martin, people would congratulate you. That's a normal job that you can take, and you're developing weapons for a respectable, profitable company. In Japan, colleges don't promote that activity. There's no internships for their military arms manufacturers, and because of the anti-militarism norm. And because of that, top talent doesn't go into developing weapons in the military. So that constrains the government's ability to use military hardware to make up the deficit in its human resources hardware. Additionally, if you think about how Japan hasn't engaged in combat over 70 years, really, live combat, and it doesn't do international arms development, not so much, they lack the combat data to develop weapons that are really ready for the modern world, the modern war, right? So that's where ideas influence the hardware. And then if we look at the political dimensions, this is now more on the software side that I've already used to explain some of the hardware changes. You have the Japanese desire to maintain neutrality out of East Asia, trying to reassure East Asia as well that it's not causing problems. And then the international stigma of every time Japan pushes the envelope to be militarized, other countries are sure to jump in to criticize Japan and try to hold it to its values that it purports in the constitution. And then the last dimension would be the normative, which is the peace constitution, nuclear principles, the activism, and all these normative dimensions that limit Japanese militarization. And I would like to quickly point out, there are several scholars that talk about demographics and great studies on the JSDF, but they look at more on, broadly speaking, do demographics lead to peace or not? They don't really apply it to the Japan case, or they frame it in terms of, is Japan, like Brad Glosserman, who's a great scholar and has been a big supporter of mine, he frames it in terms of like peak Japan. And that has a very linear view of like how a country evolves, right? Is it at its top or not? Whereas I think of it in more qualitative terms and types of cases. So I argue that to better understand Japanese policy, we have to look at it in terms of multiple militarisms, right? We can't have this, spectrum of more pacifistic or more militaristic. We should look at type. And we already see this in the literature where we talk about militarism, defensive militarism, offensive realism. And there's like, we already use the language, but it's not really developed. So I argue that we should maybe look at intentions and capabilities and how use of force is legitimized. And we can think of the military as much more complex. It has different roles such as security and state building and things such as that. And then for Japan, this is how it plays out. The JSDF is used for much more than simply the defense of Japan. It is militaristic because it will use the JSDF. It's not pacifistic. It's not an ontological rejection of the military, but it's using it for very specific purposes. So to say Japan got this new ship, it's militarizing because it's balancing it against China, is partly true, but not quite accurate on exactly what's going on. And if we look at Japanese polling data, this is an NHK poll, like their number one, for Japanese public, the number one use of the military, they think, is for like disaster relief. It's not until, the third answer where it's really to protect the country. And so we could consider maybe different types of militarism when we analyze states. So let's take a look at some of the demographics. And here's a kind of quick breakdown. You can see as the Japanese population is it's aging, right? This is how it looked like in 2015, 2020, 2030, 2050. And coincidentally, the demographic pyramid looks like an urn, right? As the country is aging and dying away. And if we look at the raw numbers, the fertility rate is now 1.32 in 2020. The population is declining quite significantly, and really declines for 12 straight years. And I think more importantly, less than a million children were born in 2016. This is important. That means if the Japanese Self-Defense Force wants to recruit its quota of 11,000 soldiers per year, it has to recruit 1% of the entire population of that cohort of babies, which is quite difficult to do, actually, because they're competing against the general economy. And then actually the Japanese population is aging quite significantly as well, and it has a high life expectancy. So it kind of plays together. And so why is this happening? Well, a lot of it has to do with like delayed marriages. It's gone up by 3 to 4 years. And the delayed marriages, a lot of it has to do with economics, because it's very difficult to survive on your own. A lot of people move back to their homes, but a lot of the economics has to do with the declining population. So think about how that plays out. The government has trouble taxing and getting more resources to improve the military for like hardware purposes. And so it might want to recruit more people, but it's like a vicious cycle of not being able to pay for things because the economy is weak and declining and shrinking. And therefore they can't really leverage the population to get new hardware. There's childbearing inequalities between men and women, the low birth rate, and really terrible work-life balance for many Japanese. So if we look at why this occurs, there's an unequal distribution of family planning costs. Women just pay a significant high cost for having children. Most of them quit their job upon childbirth. But think about it this way. The government wants to increase the amount of children in the country, and they're trying to leverage coerce women to have children. But they're the ones that benefit for state security, have more children for the state. But they're the ones that benefit least from what the state provides, right? Because they have to work more. So the solutions I look in the book aren't really working on how to get people to have more children. And then so if we look at the economics, Japan really has just anemic economic growth. There's been some studies that said if the population was growing like the United States, it would be one of the better performing economies in the world. And in some ways you could think of the Japanese economy doing as well as it could given the demographics crisis. And so this is how it plays out for the military. So because of the weak recruitment or declining population, when Japan did its kind of an advisory council on the last guidelines, the participants thought about how do we address this demographic weakness? So they had four concepts. It should be Yonin, but they went with Yonjin to kind of fit with this gene kind of theme. And one was maybe they could increase UAVs and invest in technology. They could modify its hardware to rely less on people. They could pull old people out of retirement and have them serve in the military, and then they could leverage women to be in the military. But there's limits to this, right? So the first one is, these are defensive technologies. So you can't argue Japan's being offensive if it's investing in UAV and defensive technologies, and they have to pay for it, which is difficult to do because the population is declining. There's only so much you can do in modifying your ships to make them more efficient, because you want to grow. Retrofitting doesn't really increase your capabilities. Drawing from the retirement population is difficult too, because a lot of war technologies require boots on the ground. And Japan's tried to increase the amount of women in the JSDF, but they haven't done too well on it. And then if you look at their ability to develop the technology, really Japanese companies, if you look on the right, aren't arms manufacturers. And the reason for that is a lot of these Japanese companies don't want to develop arms because they don't want to be labeled as a merchant of death, right? So this is where the norms can influence the behavior of these security companies. And so what's the result? If you can't get people to join and you can't increase your technology due to these normative reversions, what you have is limited power projection, limited success in making these changes, painful trade-offs. Do you spend 300 million yen to create female-only barracks in your submarine? Or you use that 300 million yen to buy a new carrier, or you can't afford a carrier with 300 million yen, but like to buy a new ship? Do you use that 300 million yen to do bonuses to recruit people? They have to make these painful trade-offs because of this physical limitation. And so if we look at the Self-Defense Force, it's never been able to recruit its desired quotas. And they don't really take in that many people per year because of this normative and physiological limits. Here's some polling data on people's willingness to join the military in East Asia, and you can see how the norms play a big role. So if you have a small population and you can't get enough volunteers, a lot of it has to do with, you know, people's willingness to do so, the norms, whereas in the rest of Asia, you just make them with conscription. And so you could see just a significant difference in size of the militaries in East Asia. So this is how it plays out, right? You have an aging and declining population, which leads to decreased savings and productivity. That gives the government less financial tools to invest and grow the economy in many ways. Decreased consumer spending and weakened economy because it's declining. That leads to delayed marriages, later births, because you're getting married later and there's a window in which you can have children. And then it leads to an aging, declining population. So it's this vicious cycle that Japan's caught in. And its effect on the military is you have fewer recruits, less selective recruiting and early retirements in the military. And then on the economic side, you have a limited defense budget. I'll quickly go over some of the peace culture and norms rules. So as we know, a lot of the Japan's anti-militarism norms are influenced from the atomic attacks on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And I would say it was reinvigorated after the 3/11 triple disaster too. That really reinvigorated anti-nuclear movements. So in the study, I looked at a lot of peace museums in the country, and it's mapped out. So in the gray is, the light gray is where there's a peace museum in Japan, in that prefecture, and dark gray doesn't have a peace museum, and the striped has a peace museum and a war museum. So if you think of what Japan is the size of California, each prefecture is the same size of a county. So you're driving, I guess I'm speaking to a Canadian audience, this might not work so well, but driving from Los Angeles to San Bernardino is like 30 minutes, right? That's the equivalent of going from one part prefecture to another in Japan, even though they have a lower driving speed limit. So in reality, you're really about 2 hours train ride from any spot in the country from a peace museum. It's really very much part of the physical landscape in the country. And a lot of these peace museums were created after 1990. So I would argue that peace culture has evolved and grown over time. It didn't just go away. It took on new messages. Here's like a breakdown of all the peace museums that's in Japan. It's in the appendix of the book. And so the peace culture, I would argue, is still very lively, but it has taken on new character. If you think about the aging demographics too, a lot of the A-bomb survivors and the activists are passing away. So you could look at how the norms themselves will start to evolve when the caretakers of the message pass away, and it takes on a new character with the new generation that may be more concerned about environmental issues instead of just like nuclear weapons. I also look at how the physical landscape may influence how ideas are developed. So on the left is a map of Hiroshima, and that city is very flat. And the Peace Museum is right in the center of the city, and there's a Shinkansen, a super train that goes from Tokyo to Hiroshima in a couple hours. I would argue that the peace message in Hiroshima is the dominant one in Japan because of the location of Hiroshima and the ease in which activists can host events there. And whereas Nagasaki has a much more critical view of nuclear weapons, but it's not as mainstream as Hiroshima because there's no convenient way to get to Nagasaki. And also the Nagasaki landscape doesn't have a city center. There's about 4 city centers, which divides kind of your ability to host major events and get a lot of attention in one spot. So in many ways, the actual landscape, I would argue, has an impact on how peace culture can evolve. And I would be happy to elaborate on this on specific details if people have questions on it. The last thing I'll talk about is just peace museum visits and how this and how aging affects it. So here's the amount of visitors that visit the peace museum in Hiroshima. It's gone up over the years. What's interesting though is the amount of young folks has gone down. Why? Not because peace culture is not important in Japan anymore. The likelihood of a young person going to visit a peace museum before they go to college is almost guaranteed if you look at the numbers, right? The reason why the decline has happened is because there are just fewer young people in Japan. The decrease in attendance at peace museums maps on perfectly with the decline in that age group population, right? Additionally, if you look at the school trips, they have remained the same, right? That means these groups are getting smaller because there's just fewer kids. Right. If we break it down by age, elementary school kids go far much more than the older, like middle school and high school kids. And so let's play this out. It means that when these kids are getting their peace education, they're getting a more intimate education because they're going on smaller tours to these museums. And you know they're going because the numbers map on well. But why are older students not going? Is it they don't care anymore? Well, I looked at flight data for school trips abroad and also looking at domestic travel data, and high school students are more likely to go on their school trip to other countries because of a decline in the cost of like travel to international countries like Taiwan or Korea. So they're just taking their school trips to other countries and their schools are fine with it because I guess they went when they were younger. But if we look at domestic travel, you know, Hiroshima is in the Chugoku area. The vast majority of young kids in Japan travel from the neighboring prefectures, where high school students are traveling from further prefectures. So that also confirms that older students are able to travel further distances. And there's a level where eventually they just kind of leave the region and go to a different area. So I'll leave it at there actually. And then I could talk about some of the other issues later, but I think I'd like to leave the last 20 something minutes for Q&A and I could elaborate more later. I hope that's okay.
Great, thank you, Tom. That was a very clear and cogent presentation of some of the major themes in the book, but I'd like to remind the audience that there is more where that came from. And so the book is available from Columbia University Press. So I would encourage you to pick up a copy. So please submit your questions via the Q&A feature and I'll monitor that and read your questions as they come in. But I'd like to ask the first question, since we're very close to a major election in Japan. And you know, in chapter 6 of your book, you briefly mention how now Prime Minister Kishida, his home district, of course, is the Hiroshima First District. And you talk about how he played this role as foreign minister in promoting essentially initiatives like the Youth Communication for a World Free of Nuclear Weapons. And so, you know, under previous governments, Japan has often been reluctant to embrace sort of a very clear anti-nuclear stance, right? The U.S. No first use policy has been an issue of some back and forth because Japan is somewhat reluctant to have the United States give that up. And of course, there's the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, which Japan has been criticized for not signing on to. And so I guess my question is, you know, how do you see the current prime minister Kishida as fitting into that anti-militarism ecosystem? And should we expect any change in Japanese policy as the result of his coming to prominence in government?
Yeah. Thank you. So I'll say for Kishida is that his prefecture is disappointed in him in many ways for not being more dovish on a lot of these policies. But if we think about, it's all relative, right? For him being on Abe's cabinet may have been one of the more checks, I guess, on that. And also the public is always going to be, especially in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and among the activists, it's are going to be more to the left on nuclear issues. And this is where they can have like an effect on the government. So at first, like there was the statement created by Australia regarding like the nuclear umbrella and like kind of do they support like the US program and protecting its allies? And Japan signed on to that. And then a lot of the peace activists were very critical because of Japan's history, and they criticized the government and they pressured it, and they got the Japanese government to sign on the New Zealand statement as well, which is the one that was the very opposite message. And there's the contradiction, right, that Japan signed both, which is mutually exclusive to be able to do so. And I imagine that Kishida is going to be doing that, that he has, that he will, you know, bend to the pressure of the public to not go far, but he's going to still have to deal with what U.S. pressures are and then kind of the traditional security concerns. So he has to, you know, come up with these policies within this ecosystem of domestic constraints and international constraints, but that's going to, I think, significantly limit him from what adopting nuclear policies or allowing introduction of weapons into Japan. Like, I don't see the qualitative change given those limits. And also, I would say that it's interesting how Japanese politicians think where their starting point is. So, for instance, when I interviewed Japanese politicians and I asked, like, "Will you do this?" They already said, "Well, we're not going to bother there because the public's probably going to push back. So let's start from here." Right? So think about increasing the defense budget. That's going to be the discussion. Will it go from 2%? I would argue if Prime Minister Abe had the most time in Japanese history to get it done, and the defense budget actually did not go up during his time, if you take into account inflation, I'm not quite sure how Kishida will be able to do that. And the debates around increases are interesting too. Like going to 1 to 2% is a bit arbitrary. I mean, that's just really using the NATO number to kind of pull it up. It's not actually tied to capabilities. I mean, if you need 4 aircraft carriers, then put aside $200 billion for it. But it's not, there's no like kind of that kind of deep analysis of the numbers, because they're not even that close to thinking about how they should leverage their military for traditional security purposes. So I would say the conversation's so warped by the norms of the country that even if Kishida wants to pursue traditional, you know, power balancing behavior, he's not going to be able to do it. So it's almost like it doesn't really matter what he thinks, because he'll be constrained given the limits that I point to.
Interesting. Thank you. We have a question from our good friend, David Welsh. Great book, Tom. What surprised you most as you were researching it?
Yeah, this might be a weird answer. What really, really surprised me was a lot of activists are quite wealthy. And it made sense in the end, because I was looking at these activist groups and why did they have so little money? Even Hidankyo, which is Japan's big anti-nuclear weapons group, I went to their office and it was tiny. It was all volunteers. It was like 2 people working there. And then I asked, like, well, you know, why isn't your message bigger? And they don't fundraise because a lot of these peace groups, they don't even have a grant writer in these institutions, which is kind of very normal for, like, if you look at Oxfam or something like that, it's kind of the most important job in your institution. And they argue that they don't want to promote their personal politics publicly. That's why in Japan, you rarely see people actually asking for money on the street. It's only for the dogs, for, you know, the blind kind of support, or like helping Vietnam or something like that, but rarely personal politics. So I asked them, how are you able to maintain your operations? And then you asked a couple questions, and it turns out they're independently wealthy. And then I started paying attention that they're driving kind of BMWs in Japan. It's kind of surprising, but here's the effect of it. One is it shows on how I argue peace culture is pervasive and enduring for the history and the education, but it's not hegemonic, because they don't fully leverage the tools that are available to really dominate the discourse by like promoting it and fundraising and just dominating the agenda. And also at the same time, it explains how the peace movement is in some ways changing, because it's having difficulty getting new young people to join, because they're not paying them, right? So you're getting a lot of passionate young folks that get burned out pretty quickly because they're not independently wealthy, but they want to make this their own career. So now the peace movement is now changing to be, for young people, they kind of merged it with environmental movements, and then they're able to like attract money that way, and they combine it with their peace movement. So you'll see a peace movement doing, water conservation and then Article 9, and they'll do multiple activities. So that was surprising to me to look at how personal wealth kind of plays out in the peace movements that I just did not see coming.
That's a great answer. And that's surprising to me as well. Michael Donnelly, who's emeritus professor here, asks, what about leadership? How important have been prime ministers such as Ohira Nakasone and Abe in shaping military security policy? You did not mention the role of political leadership and its capacity to prioritize. What are your thoughts about the role of individuals as leaders?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I do think for charismatic or kind of once in a generation leaders like Nakasone and Abe in particular, and it's important too, they need the time to do what they want, right? That's kind of a rarity in Japanese politics, where they go through prime ministers like we go through shirts sometimes quite quickly. And so you'll get these important leaders who are able to drive the agenda. So in my chapter 7, I look at Japan's proactive peace under Abe. And so I do argue that he's able to push the use of the military in certain ways, which is using it for like refueling missions and things such as that. So you'll have, in the cases so far in history, more conservative leaders that have tried to pull the Japanese military in more traditional security ways. But for Abe, he has to frame it as a proactive peace, right? Mm-hmm. And when he wanted the constitutional amendment, he made so many sacrifices to that. And he argued, well, I just want to clarify that the JSDF is in fact legal. Can we get there at least? So the leadership does matter, and it can pull the security policy in a certain way, but it still has to do it within the rules of the ecosystem that I talk about. So even if Abe wants to, you know, send more self-defense soldiers abroad, he only gets so many soldiers to send abroad because the population is declining. And if he wants to increase refueling missions, he only has so many ships because the country can't afford or is unwilling to pay for more. So they do matter, but they work within the constraints that I talk about.
Great, great. Amit Newfield has some questions, I think, that relate to Japan's policies vis-a-vis Taiwan and China. Essentially, you know, how seriously should we take these recent statements and moves that Japanese policymakers appear to be making in regards to should Japan play a greater role in a potential security crisis surrounding Taiwan? Is Japan serious about potentially taking on China in a military conflict situation, or is this essentially bluffing or misstatements and that we can ignore?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think a couple ways to answer this. First is, I am pretty confident this is a question that Japanese don't want to have to answer themselves, right? Because this is, they're afraid of being not being a credible ally or not securing the region, but they kind of, I would say they don't really want to put this to a test, which I would say is a different kind of conversation of security than say in other parts of the world, right? Where if for Taiwan, they're not having that question of like, do we need to answer this question or not? They know it's an existential threat. They have to address it. And even the United States, I think, is reluctant, right? That ambiguity has a purpose for it. So I wouldn't say Japan is, jumping, what's the phrase, head first or with both legs into pool. They're not that excited to get involved. So that's the first way to address it. I don't think they're going to play a big role. And if we look at the last Defense of Japan white paper, I know there was a big brouhaha over it, right? It mentioned Taiwan specifically, and then the cover was like the soldier on the steed. But it wasn't the first time that Japan mentioned Taiwan. That was already going on for a decade now. It did speak with it in more clarity in terms of Taiwan's importance for regional security. But if you look at the length of the defense papers, they were already increasing and becoming more detailed and sophisticated. And this is where I think, you know, Andrew Oros is correct, that Japan is becoming more sophisticated in its security discussion, its security renaissance. But we have to frame that in terms of this is a type of security as opposed to simply they're militarizing or not militarizing, looking at the ebb and flow of like defense expenditures. They're talking about security in a different kind of way. The second way to address it though, okay, let's say Japan will commit. So the software has shifted and now it's been optimized to say they're gonna defend Taiwan. So what are they gonna do, right? At best, they might help secure some sea lanes, maybe scramble some jets, right? Already the Air Self-Defense Force is overburdened on how many times they have to scramble to kind of scare off Chinese and Russian planes. They're not gonna have the bodies to go and go fight, right? If there's a full-on war, the Self-Defense Force is about 250,000 people and people are not gonna conscript to fight for this conflict. So that's why I focus on both dimensions on how the even if the software can change, there's a limit to how different Japanese policy will be. So if the Taiwanese are gonna be relying on Japan to tip the scales, I mean, only thing that matters there is if the United States is willing to do it, right? If Japan can play a supplementary role, it might have an effect, but it's not going to be qualitatively going to change the way the war is fought. It might give like the U.S. some cover as in they have multiple countries supporting this, right? That's more of a political issue more so than capabilities.
Great. Anuj Barnabas has a question about, in the presentation you mentioned sort of the weakness of Japan's military forces in some sense, but doesn't advanced technology compensate for some of these weaknesses to some degree?
Yeah, absolutely, right? That's where we think of the soldier as like the hardware and the military weapons too. And Japan's self-defense force is well respected for the quality training of this jiaitaiin and also of the weapons that it has. It also has like a high operational rate, like compared to US planes and ships, like they don't break down as much, but a couple of things to look at. It's not as if the countries that Japan would be concerned about, like China, South Korea, aren't also building up their technology. So it's at best, it's kind of keeping parity, right? Not many people realize this, but the South Korean defense budget is now equal to that of Japan, right? So, and that's a country that's much smaller in terms of people, in terms of economy size. So even with the advanced technology, there's a limit. Additionally, a lot of the Japanese budget, I break this down in the book, goes to maintenance of old stuff, and they don't really buy new stuff. Additionally, because they don't have a strong indigenous weapons defense sector, and they don't import much, they way overpay for the technology they have. So they're not efficient with how they use their money. They're kind of overly reliant on foreign military sales from the United States. And the US really, I would say, kind of rips them off in some way. So like they do have nice technology, but it's compared to other countries in the region, that there's a limit to that. Also, from my conversations with defense contractors and self-defense force members, they have a high operational rate during peacetime. So if they were to enter war, we can expect the operational rate to go down because it's used more and it's abused more and things like that. But so the Japanese military and its technology is good. It's operating efficiently at its status, but the country does not have excess, right? They don't have so much extra bodies or equipment to make up that deficit. And from my conversations with military in the US, when it comes to matters of war, you want excess because things go wrong, right? And that's where the Japanese logic is just not there yet, because they've had to operate the military in terms of austerity as opposed to in terms of excess.
Yeah, great. So one question I had while I was reading the book is the role of the Japan Communist Party. You know, as you know, the JCP is receiving increased attention because of its electoral cooperation that seems to be developing and becoming deeper and deeper over time with the primary opposition party, the CDPJ. And in many ways, the Communist Party at least portrays itself as a stalwart defender of some of these post-war anti-militarist norms. But if you look at the way the election is unfolding, the LDP seems to see kind of attacking the JCP on its stances on things like the US-Japan alliance or the status of the self-defense forces, attacking them as a winning issue. And then the more they can attack the Communist Party and attach these issues to the CDPJ as well, the more the LDP will benefit. It seems to be the political calculation. And so I'm curious what you think the JCP's role is within this kind of anti-militarist ecosystem that you think. Yeah.
This is where I would love to defer to Tobias Harris, who follows domestic politics really well. For the JCP, I would say when it comes to party politics, I would say Komeito matters much more when it comes to constraining this, because they're able to build a coalition with the LDP and prevent amendments and these major changes. So I would look to them more as kind of significant. And then I did a lot of interviews with Soka Gakkai and looked at the kind of their more kind of lobbyist arm, but they don't operate like our lobbyists in the United States, but they have a influence too on kind of constraining it. For the JCP, I'd say ultimately their issue is always, it's going to be a branding issue, especially in 2021, right? And so I saw them campaigning when I was in Japan. I actually met Kishida while he was campaigning in Japan and kind of spoke with him for a second. And it's pretty clear the JCP is not competitive when it comes to dominating the agenda. But I don't know if this is, I don't understand the strategy in the sense it's not like Japanese voters are voting on foreign policy issues over bread and butter issues and the aging population and the economy, right? So attacking the US-Japan alliance in 2021, I don't see why that's a great strategy for the JCP or that overly draconian anti-true pacifism. And the effect that has had actually is it leads to splintering within the peace groups in Japan. So actually there's Nihon Hidankyo, which is the national organization. And there's the Hiroshima Hidankyo, which is the atomic bomb survivor group in Hiroshima. That's actually been split for decades now in two groups, the more socialist, pure pacifist And then kind of more pragmatists, I guess you could say, who think there's a value in the alliance, but they still want to have a limited footprint. So what it does is it leads to genuine debates within the peace community on how they want to move forward. And it kind of lets the discourse evolve, right? So that's how you get like the Women's Active Museum and look at how in Japan you have people more critical of the war history. If you look at peace museums in Japan, the later museums that are built are definitely more niche and more critical of like traditional security policy. So I would say that their stance is reflected in pockets in the country that contribute to how anti-militarism can evolve and stay vibrant over time, but it's not hegemonic, right? This kind of strict anti-war attitude is not hegemonic. It just influences the degree in which the country will move towards the more traditional militarism direction.
Well, thank you. So we could keep on going on, but unfortunately we are just about at the end of our time. So I would like to say thank you, Tom, for such a fascinating talk about your book, as well as Q&A, and to our audience members, as always, for the great questions. Japan's Aging Peace from Columbia University Press. Highly recommended. Pick up your copy. Unlike some of my academic books that are priced beyond the budget of most people, this one is a priced at a reasonable point, so you should be able to pick one up without too much trouble. But thank you, Tom, again, for coming to speak with us today, and I will give you the last word.
All right. Well, I would just like to thank everyone for this opportunity. I'd love to engage in discussion further. There's so much more to talk about, and that's why I wrote it, to put it out there, just to talk about how do we think about the use of the military. Instead of thinking about why Japan's an outlier, maybe we could look at that as a model for other countries on why can't we use our military in kind of in different ways. And lastly, do you celebrate Halloween in Canada? If so, everyone's
we do. Safe. We do indeed.
I hope everyone does it safe. All right. That's
all right. On that note, thank you and bye.